Social media, you hear about it, talked in the newspaper, you know, is it relevant? Well, yeah, probably is relevant when you look at yesterday's back page of the Western Mail. My stars must ignore Twitter abuse and fire, says Broughton Gatland about Wales. You know, unfairly or not, whether Wales have had criticism, but Twitter's been in the news there. Yesterday's Evening Post, Twitter case man due in court. A man accused of sending abusive messages to the social media site Twitter has had harassment charges against him dropped and so on. So you can see, you know, Twitter is up there in the news, and sometimes for all the wrong reasons. You'll have seen all the publicity about the abuse case in North Wales and how they involved Lord McAlpine in that. There's lots of people in trouble with what they said on Twitter about Lord McAlpine, and Lord McAlpine's lawyers is busy backtracking now to find out who said what about Lord McAlpine and to see what damages they can claim against him. You've got the, those you remember, the footballer Ched Evans, who was a rape case in North Wales. And again, it's a case where people went on Twitter and actually identified the victim in the case, which you can't do. And those guys ended up in court, and they're up in court. Now, those are examples of where it goes wrong. You know, but I'd like to think that, you know, what we're going to focus on is the more positive stuff for what social media can do. And there is positive, plenty of positive stuff out there that social media does. I mean, you know, give you a good example of how it works well. You'll all remember the unfortunate April Jones case up in Machynlleth. And, you know, it's social media that actually mobilised all those volunteers to get out there, you know, to get down to Machynlleth and to search for the poor girl. You know, so that was how quick people were able to react to things. So it is a force for good. And I'll give you an example from today. Did anybody see Breakfast Time this morning?
Yes.
You might have caught on Breakfast News this chap. He saw on Facebook that his cousin needed a kidney transplant. So he saw that on Facebook, and he decided to make the 3,500-mile journey over to the UK to give his cousin a new kidney. You know, so it is a force for good. A little bit, you're all here as well from social enterprises, people involved in the community and partnerships and so on. And I should explain at the outset that I'm fairly heavily committed myself in terms of what I do. Yeah, a great believer in community work and in community work being a power for good. I do work for a number of charities. I'm the chairman of the Llechi Talking Newspaper for the Blind. And this summer, I actually spent most of the summer volunteering. I was one of Seb Coe's games makers at the London Olympics and at the Paralympics. So, you know, I know lots of you do very commendable work out there in the community, and you deserve the highest praise for that. Anyway, back to social media. I'm going to show you a little video now, which hopefully, if it works, it'll be here. And this is something which has been done to reflect where social media is in 2012, it's actually talking about 2013. It's a bit Americanized, okay, so you'll have to excuse that. But the themes are very much the same. The statistics, you know, are mind-blowing. And just watch it and see what you think.
Thank you.
I mean, there's some astonishing statistics there. I mean, the one that sort of freaks me out a bit is that something like 2% of X percent of children under the age of 2 have a digital footprint, that actually they have a web presence at the moment. But that video is available on YouTube, and all you look for is social media 2013. But the statistics in there, they are a bit Americanized in terms of they're talking Ivy League rather than Premier League football clubs and Fortune magazine rather than anything else. But you'll get the drift of what's going on here. I didn't take this bit off either, because you've seen that bit, and that's an advert. This is how YouTube and Google and all these people make money. It's advertising linked to what they put up on the web. Okay, we'll go back, just backtrack a little bit onto websites. And lots of you said that you had websites. I mean, do you all run them yourselves, or do you farm them out to people? You run them yourself? Yeah. Websites are actually relatively cheap to establish nowadays. You can buy domain names for under £14 or whatever. You can buy server space for your domain at under £30 for like 2 years. So if you haven't got a website, then you really need to think about having one. Even if it's just a splash page that actually says your name, your contact telephone number, what hours you're open for business. It doesn't have to be an all singing, all dancing website, but it needs to be a presence that you've got up there on the web. If you haven't got a website yet, you do need to think of one, because there are people out there who look at enterprises like yourself, and they'll go off and they'll simply buy names. If they know that John Jones Social Enterprise Tinelli is an organization, they will go off and register the name, preventing you from accessing that name in the future. I say I'm not here to talk an awful lot about websites, but I'm quite happy to take a few questions at this stage about websites in general, if anybody's got any questions. Stony silence. Okay, what I would say about websites is, yes, have one, a splash page which actually gives your details. But there are three things to remember websites with if you're going to expand them, and the three things are very simple. It's content. You've just got to build content up on your website, because content is king. Content is the reason people will come back to your website time and time again. You're now going to ask me, have I got a website? Yes, I've got a website. It's not a very big website, because it just does simple things for me. It's basically 5 pages. But what I've got on the front end of this, I do link in to my Twitter account. So you can see that that's updated on a fairly regular basis. And that last one says Nigel Kershaw, Chief Executive, Big Issue, made the keynote speech at today's event. So the front page is reasonably dynamic like that, that it will change. And behind this, I have another blog running. But I'll just show you the web pages first of all. It's very simple, and again, there's no need to have an all singing, all dancing website. This just carries news stories. And if I've got a news story I put up, I simply put it up as what we call an RSS feed. Does everybody know what RSS is? No. It's a syndication service, which if you look up RSS on the internet, if you run things like blogs, then you can set up a syndication service. You can actually give people the code so they can get access to a running feed from your blog. And what this does, if you just click on it, it takes you off to my blog and to the relevant story.
So what do the initials stand for?
Which initials?
RSS.
RSS. But I knew somebody would ask that. I'll look it up. It's rapid serial syndication or something like that. Okay. But I need to, I'd have to check that out. But
it's really, really simple.
Really?
Really simple.
Really simple syndication. This man wins the prize. Yeah? Added to this, then, I have a link for my clients, and each one of these links takes you off to another web page, which is for the client. Links for people who are occasional clients and other people, including some charities I support. And then the all-important contact, you know, how to get in touch with me, how to ring my mobile, how to get in touch with me by email, and so on. It's the quick route in. So again, last time I'll say it, if you haven't got a website, then consider having one. And if you don't want to branch into a website at the moment, consider registering a domain name in the name of your organization before somebody else out there goes and registers it for you, and then you end up with having to buy it off them. Okay? Who here uses Google Plus? Yeah? Okay, not so many on Google Plus. Google Plus is relatively new, but it's running there as a sort of hybrid Facebook, Twitter account. Google, I tend to advise people to use quite a lot, because does everybody here have a Google Mail account?
No.
If you don't have a Google Mail account, it's free, so which makes it easy. Think about it, you know, signing up for a Google Mail account, because Google Mail will give you access to email storage. It'll give you access to storing documents online, to storing pictures online. It'll give you a YouTube account. It'll give you an analytics account as well. I use something called Google Analytics, which we use to sort of monitor traffic on our websites. You know, and Google Analytics is very good, actually. It'll give you analysis of demographically and geographically who's been using your website now. So if you haven't got a Google Mail account, then consider having one, because it does open up a range of activities for you. LinkedIn, I tend to describe to people as it's Facebook for professional people. When you look at it, the interface is very similar to Facebook, in that you'll get a series of regular updates. It's a huge networking tool. You know, I think you saw a statistic on the video about how many people join LinkedIn every couple of seconds. You have physically, you know, it's the alternative to a business breakfast or a networking lunch, whatever. You can put your own profile up there, and again, the trick to all this is when you put yourself up there, that you put enough information about yourself so that people can find you. You put your areas of expertise, you put your profile up there, and then people connect you, and you can see the connections that are going on this morning. Kathy, who's runs a shop in Llanelli, she's now connected to somebody in the Siamano Hotel. Roger Dollar is a photographer connected to Simon Newsman at Altoid. But these are all connections that are being made all the time. I mean, my LinkedIn network tells me that I've got 442 connections, which links me to 3 million plus professionals. It tends to be all professional people, and the sort of level of conversation on here is subtly different to that on Facebook. Facebook is quite chatty and, you know, very social. This is all about business, you know, and there are groups which are set up on LinkedIn which will be dedicated to areas of business expertise. It's a bit like, I think, what do they just describe as 7 degrees of separation? Like, you know, I make a network connection with Ken because Ken has 10 network connections further down the road. Then all of a sudden I see what his connections are, and, you know, I gradually build up my network of contacts. I'd say it is focused on business users. as with all these things, there comes a health warning. You know, these things can be addictive. And, you know, I'll say to people, you know, lots of these things are time bandits. They will steal your time. You know, so, you know, be careful about how you use them. You need to sort of discipline yourself so you don't get too sucked into it and it doesn't eat up too much of your time. Lots of people, they join LinkedIn because they get an invitation from somebody like me, but you know, lots of them don't go on LinkedIn regularly because they're too busy. How to use it? Make sure you've got a good profile, and this is where I'm probably going to regret this bit, because my profile probably needs updating. But it says here that 5 guys have endorsed me for my skills and expertise. It says what experience I've got, where I was educated, what my blog and other web activity is. And it also carries a feed of my latest news items and so on. So again, doesn't cost you anything. You can go over something called LinkedIn Premium, which does actually cost you money. But quite honestly, I don't think that's worth it. You know, a basic LinkedIn account will do the business for you. It's also a good way.
Question. When you've got your address there,
yeah.
The thing that worries me about social media is the risk of identity theft.
Yeah.
So you've got very personal information there.
That's right. I mean, you know, my personal information is up there because, you know, I've taken a judgment call that everybody knows who I am and where I live by now. And I've crossed the threshold of being anonymous. It may be that, you know, if I was starting up in business again, I might take another view on it. But I, you know, personally, you know, I crossed that threshold a long time ago. And in fact, in my job, you know, I have to be available sort of 24/7 anyway, so it's actually, you know, it does mean a lot for me to be up there as being available. But you know, I can see what you're saying. You put in information up there. It's the same as you put your date of birth on Facebook and all that. You give in information out there. You know, and you're quite right. You know, there is that warning that you have to pitch to people and say, well, okay, put in this information up there. Please be wary that you could be susceptible to identity theft and so on.
The chances are that people you're linking in with or
yeah.
using, you know anyway, you're not going to link in with any.
I mean, to be honest, that's another important point about LinkedIn. You know, don't make the mistake of going on LinkedIn and linking to people you don't know. You know, because, you know, just as you think, oh, I'd like to be LinkedIn with Richard Branson. You know, these people tend to think it's a bit of a pain in the neck if they're constantly being asked to link to people that they don't know. You know, so always make that judgment call in your head. You know, do you actually know them? Do you know them well enough to link in with them?
You can view their details and stuff before you accept them. Anyway.
Yeah, that's right. You can view their information and then decide, you know, whether you don't have to accept every invitation you've got to LinkedIn. You're absolutely right. The other bit about security and what this gentleman mentioned is, you know, I say this to everybody, is have a routine about passwords and changing passwords as well. You know, that, you know, certainly once every month you put it in your calendar to change passwords on material like this, because people do hack Facebook accounts, they hack Twitter accounts and so on. You know, also in an environment like this, always be wary of the fact that if you've got a computer turned on and it's logged into your Twitter or your Facebook account, don't leave it alone or shut it down. Because, you know, I've seen people, you know, through empties, somebody decides for a joke, they'll jump on the machine and they'll do something funny on your Twitter or your Facebook page. You know, so beware of, you know, some people think it's good-natured fun, but it can blow up in your face. Okay?
Can I ask if you change your password every month?
Yeah.
For everything?
Basically, for, you know, most of, I mean, there are some things that I don't change. I won't tell you what they are, but but
no, it's just, does anybody else do that every month?
I'm very impressed with your memory if you can remember all your passwords.
Yeah. and again, there is a trick to actually, you know, tell people this. You know, all passwords, you know, don't do the cliche date of birth and
or password.
You think of alphanumeric things and I won't tell you what I do now, but I used to have a thing going with scores. You know, there were scores from key games that I used the alphanumeric in the password. They wouldn't, it wouldn't be 0903, one after the other, but it would be dotted through the thing. So
there was a survey done, wasn't there?
Yeah.
Someone sent, 80% of people's password was password.
Yeah, that's right. And it's astonishing the amount of people who actually stick their first name and their date of birth in. Yeah. Rules for using LinkedIn, only invite people you've met or you know. So if you send out random invitations, you'll end up annoying people and getting a bad reputation. Don't treat it as a point scoring exercise. And again, this applies to lots of this stuff. It's better to have 30 very good contacts than 100 people you don't really know, okay? So all these things, it's a bit of a cliche, but size doesn't matter in this case. So think about having meaningful contacts, people you actually do business with, rather than lots of random contacts who you don't actually know or deal with. You mentioned about invitations. When you meet someone the first time, do send them an invitation to join LinkedIn. Try not to include personal or wacky stuff on your profile. Spend time on updating your profile, and this is something probably I need to do, because it does actually tell you your profile is 80% up to date, whatever. It does actually hint to you that you need to do a bit of work on it. This statistic is probably out of date by now, as you saw from the video. It says here that LinkedIn has hit the 10 million user mark in the UK, but it's probably in excess of that now. The other thing with LinkedIn, particularly if you're part of an organization, if you've got more than one person involved in the organization, ask yourself the question, does everybody have to be on LinkedIn? Because if there's four of you in the organization, decide amongst yourselves who is the one person that is the face of the organization and make them the person that goes on LinkedIn. Rather than have four people cluttering it up, you have one dedicated person who is the face of your organization and put them on LinkedIn.
I was going to ask a question about that then, because for instance, I have a number of hats in my working life, obviously you do, so I can see the value in being on LinkedIn personally, and that's probably true for my colleagues on work. So what would be the way that we, if we were all on, is it about, where you've got your list of workplaces or education that only one of you puts the organisation on there?
There is actually a way of putting the organisation and the company on there as well. So you can actually put like a company profile on there as well, which again, to be honest, I'm not too familiar with, but I know it can be done. But that might be the approach.
Like Biscuit Manor, presumably.
That's right. Okay,
so facts. Can you give us an example of what you'd do with it, or how you'd actually use it?
With LinkedIn, it's purely networking, and the trick is, you have to look at it professionally. I mean, my LinkedIn contacts are people involved in PR, public relations, journalism, marketing. They're all people that I would want to connect with in order to do business. The game.
So do you message them individually, or do you just put the blanket?
If I answer it, you can, and there are groups of professional groups. There's a PR marketing group for Wales, and I'm a member of that. So that's made up like 30 PR marketing people in Wales. So one quick hit gets my message across to them. So if I wanted to say to them, here's an event happening in Llechi today, do you want to support it, come along? In one hit, I just simply message that group of users and they all get to know about it. But it's a very professional thing. Go on, Carl.
And does that then go into their email?
It depends how you set up LinkedIn. You can set it up to give yourself alerts. I've got it set up. So if, say, somebody sends me a message, that message will also come through to my email address and say, check your LinkedIn. You don't necessarily have to do that. You can actually just let it go and check it periodically. But for my purposes, I like to know if somebody's got something to say to me, and it's set up. So if somebody sends a message for me in LinkedIn, I'd get it on email as a backup as well. And it was how we go off and look at LinkedIn. I mean, lots of people use it as an alternative to email a lot. I think there was a statistic that came up in the film there about, you know, email becoming a bit passe, you know, that people are into direct messages, saying things on Twitter, saying things on Facebook. And again, LinkedIn can work a bit like that, because I've got 2 meetings next week, you know, which again, there's no email track on that as such. It's basically contacts made on LinkedIn, and we've discussed the meeting and the content of the meeting on the LinkedIn website, you know, but not in a public area, but in a private area. Carl, you're going to ask or do?
No, all I was going to mention was that I was never going to bother having a LinkedIn profile, but it was actually my friends over here at the Digital Accessibility Centre who said, oh, you really should.
Yeah.
As a result of my LinkedIn profile, I've got my own business as well.
Yeah.
And it's actually my LinkedIn profile that has generated me the most business, because it's much more focused. You get much more relevant contacts and relevant conversation going.
That's right. I mean, you know, the distinction is that, you know, Facebook tends to be a conversation you might be having, you know, in the bar or, you know, on the street corner, you know, about somebody's birthday. Or it's more lighthearted. LinkedIn is very much professional. I wonder what that is. On LinkedIn you are actually expected, you know, to conform to those professional rules as well. I mean, they don't want an awful lot of quirky chit chat on there.
Most people use LinkedIn, it's for a professional
basis
anyway. Facebook
is
more social. That's right. But it was originally more aimed at professionalism, but it's gone on just basically a way to harass celebrities.
Yeah. Okay.
It is.
So I know some of you may have seen this before actually, but it's a very quick video. What it's about, you know, words are very important, and words are everything in terms of social media. This isn't directly about social media, but it tells you a lot about words. Choose within these strands of social media which bits you want to get involved with. You know, and some people choose not to get involved in Facebook. I mean, I use it quite heavily because I also have a number of pages set up for clients, and these are either being set up by clients or they're set up by me to service the clients. And, you know, everybody from Kilkenny Farm Shop to Ashburton Golf Club, Jenkins Bakery. They're separate pages which actually run separate Facebook accounts, but all run off master copies, like the client would have an administration account, and I would have an administration account as well, and basically they just give you all the latest information for the clients. You know, they're a useful tool for promoting yourself. The tips for using Facebook. Well, first of all, it provides information about your business, you know, and you can set up, you don't have to have a personal, you can have a personal Facebook account, and if you've got a personal Facebook account, keep it just for that, keep it for personal stuff, keep it for, you know, I'm seeing Uncle Harry in the pub tonight and this is his 70th birthday. Try not to mix the business and the personal stuff. So if you want to set up a business page, then simply set up, you can set up pages for everything from choir to a sports organization to a business, and again you can put a lot of information on there. And again, with all of this stuff, the trick is the pollination of linking things back and forth. You know, don't put these things up there in isolation. Don't put a Facebook page up there that isn't linked back to your website or linked to your Twitter account or linked to any other page, a blog or whatever that you see fit. You know, because the idea is that you put in lots of these little seeds out there in the World Wide Web, and people are then going to make contact with you and with your organisations through them. Some people will come in through a Twitter route, some people will come at you through a Facebook route, some will see the website, and so on. So you're creating lots of opportunities out there. You're seeding the internet with all this stuff about yourself. And people look at Facebook and they say, what's the reason for businesses being up there? Well, one reason can be, you know, you don't want your business to be boring. You know, and you know, on Facebook, you know, the tone is a bit chattier. You know, if you've got events on, you can create events pages and so on. You know, so it's a little bit more trendy to be on there. And again, if you've got a business page, it was actually, this is recently set up, in fact, for Cwmcerig, and they won't mind me showing this. I mean, it's only got 64 likes at the moment, but you can actually get insights into what traffic is going on your Facebook page. You know, and that'll tell you how many people are talking about it, how many people you've reached, how many posts have been viewed. It'll tell you what posts have been seen most. There's a big hit there, down at 46, we're comparing it. News of 2 Taste of Wales awards, you know, so quite a lot of people visited the page for that. So you can keep track of who's going on your page. Again, you can customize your business page. You give yourself a proper URL, and you know, the URL is the web address, which says, you know, cwmcerigfarmshop.co.uk. Well, on Facebook, and this one actually says it's Facebook, www.facebook.com and then /cwmcerigfarmshop. That is a relatively easy to remember address to access the Facebook content for Cwmcerig. You can post pictures on the site, you can post videos on the site. It's good for generating word of mouth buzz. Again, you know, all your friends on Facebook, you know, will see information. It's yet another way of enhancing your online presence.
Massive amount of free publicity for the...
Yeah, you know, and it's free.
So many people, you know, use it. Word of mouth, it'll travel really quickly.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, you talk about things being viral and all that, and, you know, things do tend to take off very quickly. You know, I can put something up on the Cwmcerig shop. If I said, they're giving free turkeys away at 6 o'clock tonight, then that'll go viral very quickly, and there'll be a queue of cars up there at 6 o'clock. It's not all one way, this. What you've got to bear in mind, lots of this social media stuff, if you go on there and you're just being one person giving out information, it won't work for you, okay? It's got to be a conversation with people. So you can have, you know, 1,000 Twitter followers and all that, but if you're not engaged with them and you're not communicating with them, then it's not actually doing anything for you. You know, so when you use stuff like this, you've got to bear in mind that it's a two-way communication thing. And if something like this is very important, communication with customers. I mean, Yeah, I'll give you this example because we had an issue on, well, not an issue, it was straightforward. It was a customer complaint that went up on the Comcare site. And we thought, well, you know, should we leave it up there or not? Well, we left it up there because there were other people that then loaded favourable comments about the site, you know, and their customer service. And the favourable stuff outweighed the negative stuff, and it turned into a positive at the end of it. But it's worth monitoring this stuff. If you're going to put yourself up there, you've got to keep a weather eye on it because there will come days when somebody puts something up there and says, oh, the service from Joe Bloggs at such and such shop was rubbish, and so you've got to monitor it. Again, you can use it to provide customer service and support. You know, if people can go on here if they've got problems, and you can help to deal with that. Keep an eye on customer opinions. 5 minutes, I get a 5 minute warning in the back there now. Keep an eye on customer opinions. Again, you know, as all this, it needs to be used on a regular basis. There's no point you having a Facebook account and you're only going to use it once a month. You know, you need to be going on there a couple of times a week, or you know, at least some people go on every day. The gentleman in the front here did mention, and asked if there's software out there that helps you blitz social media. Well, there are lots of different types of software out there. There's a bit of software that you can actually load in your tweets for the week, and they'll simply scattergun them and put them out in your Twitter feed as the week goes on. There are bits of software out there, if you put something up on Twitter, it'll send the same feed to Facebook, to LinkedIn, to other things.
What are they called, please?
It's a good question, and there's so much out there, to be honest.
It's not TweetDoc or something like that.
There are loads of them, and what you've got to do is actually find the one that works for you, because I'm actually helping to trial something for a chap who's doing some software work at the moment, so I can't tell you what I'm using, unfortunately, but if you just search the internet for stuff which, how do I get my Twitter feeds into Facebook or other social media, you'll get results galore. This is mobile as well. Those of you with mobile phones, you've got Facebook on your mobile phones, you've got Twitter on your mobile phones, so you can promote your business on the move, so to speak. You can use it for research and development. You can put polls up here. If you would put a poll up saying, what's the best meat you can buy at Comcare today? You know, do you prefer turkey to lamb, whatever? And you can get people to respond, so that's creating some interaction with people. I'm conscious of the fact I'm racing this because Carl is looking nasty at me there. But Tumblr is another bit of social media which some people use. To be honest, I'm not totally familiar with it, but you'll see the name out there. Twitter is basically one of my main avenues. And Twitter here, I've got something like 1,252 followers. Again, you know, don't get too hooked up by the follower thing. I mean, if you're a small operation and you've got 71 followers, then that's fine. I think you know it's important for you to be aware of, you know, it's quality, not quantity, that counts there.
Yeah, with Twitter, is it personal or can you be a business?
I actually do both on Twitter, in fact. Because I was described the other day as a Twitter prostitute because quite simply, I'm totally unashamed of this. You know, I used it as a vehicle for promoting myself, for promoting my clients, and so on. And part of the way of doing that is that I have a sort of USP of, you know, I like to be fairly jokey and upbeat about things, so occasionally I slip in something humorous or something a bit personal, so people, it's not just me being the Twitter prostitute trying to sell them something, so I'm trying to sell them buns at Jenkins Bakery. It's something that, you know, which can be a bit more relevant to them.
Sorry, can I just ask, do you have two separate, when you say that you promote yourself and the business, do you have two separate accounts, or because
no,
you have it?
With this, I've just gone for one account as myself.
Mm. You can have more than one if you want.
Yeah, you can have more than one. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you ask yourself the question: do you want a personal one? Do you want, you know, I mean, lots of people put personal ones out there. You know, invent a name for themselves. You know, retired bloke or whatever, and you know, they go off under that. But I say it tends to be, you know, a mix of, I use it basically as a mix of what's happening. I also use it to promote my clients, I also use it to promote events or people out there I think are interested or worthy of help. You know, so if it's a community organisation that needs some help, then I'll do that for them, and I'll do it for nothing. I'll just race through some quick tips. Carl, we've got 2 minutes.
No, you're fine.
The 20 tactics for using Twitter for business. Hashtags, have you heard of hashtags? Yeah. Hashtags are those vertical and horizontal lines, and they can be used to denote, you know, key phrases. I mean, that one I've actually put up, social enterprise. It's just another way of searching for things, you know. You can also be cheeky sometimes if you think there's something in the news that'll help you get profile. Then be a bit jokey and do something with it. Can confirm David Beckham unlikely to be offered a contract with Carmarthen in Town. Pity, because the WI had hoped for Victoria, you know. But that gives the Carmarthen Town Twitter address. And anybody searching with David Beckham in Twitter, that would come up in their Twitter feed. You know, it's a cheeky way of exploiting something in the news for getting your name out there and getting your presence out there. It's daft, but it does sometimes work. You can share tips on business, you can share photos, highlights from a conference or events. So those of you who are on Twitter today, perhaps you can stick some tweets out there. You can link to content elsewhere, you know, and this is what I use a lot of it for. You know, if there's something that I want to link back to somewhere else, I mean, Rob Morgan, who sells Christmas trees on the Gower, is one of my clients, and he was on the BBC's Gower programme on Tuesday night. So I've linked it back to the iPlayer on the web. So anybody that missed that show on Tuesday night, they can catch up with it again. It's a great tool for pointing people back to other websites and so on.
It's also a great resource tool. I don't know if people realise that. The amount of information that's available on Twitter is unbelievable.
I mean, you know, also what I would do, you know, initially if you go on Twitter, you know, is look for those like-minded people. You know, if your speciality is, you know, selling tyres, then look for people on there who sell tyres, because you've almost, they're a community in their own right. And if, you know, Di Jones up in Hull, you know, has a new idea for selling tyres, you know, you might put it up on Twitter and you get a free tip from somebody up there. Again, you know, try to be consistent. If you've got photographs that are going up on your website, on Twitter, on Facebook, try to use roughly the same photographs you can. So you're creating this brand identity for yourself time and time again. I think you mentioned there, it probably comes under, you know, follow experts, companies, competitors, and leaders in your particular field. You know, if you follow people like that, then you're going to learn something.
It gives you a chance to keep an eye on your competitors.
Yeah,
well.
That's right. Yeah, and there's one sort of final one. You know, if you go on Twitter, say, you know, be authentic, be genuine, be real. You know, I know it's a bit of a cliche, but be yourself, basically. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.